All right. Hello and welcome everyone to Politics and Prose Live. My name is Bashan. I am part of the events team with Politics and Prose. We are excited to bring you today's event. Before we get started, I'm going to just go over a few quick things. The first is that today, if anyone makes any donations, then they all will be going towards the Hurston Wright Foundation, which is the purpose for us all gathering here today. In addition to that, at any point during the event, if anyone would like to purchase a copy of any of the works of these several award-nominated artists, you can go to the chat section where you'll be able to find a link to the Politics and Prose website to purchase a copy of each of the nominated books. Of course, we highly encourage any patronizing of the books, as that helps to allow us to bring you these events in the first place. Additionally, we may not have time to get to a lot, but if you would like to try to ask any questions of the authors, we would ask for you to put them separately into the Q&A box just to help facilitate any questions and answers as we go through that process. Let me now inform everyone why we are here. We are here because the Hurston Wright Legacy Award honors the best in Black literature in the United States and around the globe. Introduced in 2001, the Legacy Award was the first national award presented to Black writers by a national organization of Black writers. Fiction, nonfiction, and poetry honorees are selected in a juried competition. This event is to celebrate the 2020 nominees for the fiction category. This is the third of three events celebrating Hurston Wright Legacy Award nominees. And this particular program is going to be moderated by Miss Glory Edim. And on that note, Glory, the floor is yours.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight. I'm so excited to say congratulations to the nominees. We're in store for some wonderful readings. We hope that you purchase the book and donate to the Hurston Wright Foundation. And again, if you have questions at the end, we'll be taking them and you can place them right in the Q&A box here in the chat section. So I'm going to kick things off by reading the bios of everyone. So Ron A. Austin's short stories have been placed in Story Quarterly, Ninth Letter, Black Warrior Review, and other journals. Avery Colt is a snake, a thief, a liar. His first collection of linked stories has received several honors and was supported by grants from the Regional Arts Commission, including a 2016 Artist Fellowship. He and his partner Jenny and son Elijah live in St. Louis. Kalisha Buckhanon's novel, Speaking of Summer, is praised by today's finest writers, such as Jesmyne Ward and Tiare Jones. Her novel was featured in Well-Read Black Girl, and she attended our festival last year. And she's done a true crime commentary for BET and TV1. She is a Kankakee, Illinois native. Jeffrey Colvin's debut novel, Africaville, was awarded a 2020 Honor Fiction Prize by the Black Caucus of the American Library Association. He is an assistant editor at Narrative Magazine, and this fall, he is the Hudson Trust John Carter Brown Fellow at Brown University. Sion Dayson is an American author and voice actor who has lived abroad for over a dozen years. After a decade in Paris, Sion now resides in Spain, where she brings her passions for storytelling and service to voiceover projects. As a River is her first novel. Rayon Amil Carr Scott is the author of the story collection, The World Doesn't Require You. His debut story collection, Insurrections, was awarded the 2017 Penn Bingham Prize for debut. His work has been published in journals such as The Keon Review, Crab Orchard Review, The Rumpus, among others. Margaret Wilkerson Sexton, born and raised in New Orleans, studied creative writing at Dartmouth College and law at UC Berkeley. Her most recent novel, The Revisioners, won an NAAC Image Award for Outstanding Literary Work. Her debut novel, A Kind of Freedom, was long listed for the National Book Award. She lives in Oakland with her family. Thank you all again for joining us. We're going to start the reading with Ron. Hey, Ron. You ready to go?
All right. Yep. So I'll get us started. How are y'all doing tonight? Doing pretty good. All right. So first, I wanted to say thanks to Glory for the introduction. Thanks to the Hurston Wright Foundation and all the event organizers. I'm pretty excited just to be here. And congratulations to all the nominees. This is exciting. So I'm going to go ahead and read the intro of the last story from Avery. Colt is a snake, a thief, a liar. So just imagine you read like 150 pages beforehand and it had all this really great tension and you want to find out how it ends. So that should really make this a lot more interesting. So, all right, I'll jump right in. This one is Nobody Promised Milk and Honey. Before the corner store failed, Grandma used to sit out front and gut buckets of fresh catfish Granddad had caught that morning. Those catfish flopped over each other, fins slapping, mouths gasping, gills slicing open into long red slits. She'd pull a paring knife from her apron, set down newspaper, and clean them right there on the curb. Sludge dripping guts glowed in the sun, a clutch of bruised rubies. Once she had the fish frying inside, she'd stand in the doorway and hawk lunch specials. She'd be hollering, come and get it, come and get it. Fresh big lip catfish straight out the muddy Mississippi. Hang a tooth on that cornmeal crust. Hot sauce and onions ain't never had a better friend. I said, come on, y'all. Them pans is burning up. That grease is popping. Them catfish is jumping. Boy, is they jumping. Truth is, I wanted my first job to be at Grandma and Granddad's corner store so I could rattle open those iron gates at dawn, fire up that oil drum smoker, and squint as Cole snapped a chorus. I wanted to shave cloudy chunks of ice for snow cones, pickle hot peppers harvested from Grandma's garden, roast chicken bones and gizzards for that good gravy. I wanted to sneak rings from the toy machine to young kids and hope aluminum hearts might ward off misfortune. I wanted to ride my bike and deliver platters of snoots, neck bones, and ham hocks. I wanted to holler lunch specials at day laborers, bless lottery tickets, and haggle over dusty cans of sweet yams with mean, goat-bearded women who knew how to stretch a dollar further than Laffy Taffy, for real. I'd smooth wrinkles out of sweat-soaked dollars sourced from the heels of boots, the bottom of bras, ignore that damp funk and praise working folks. At the end of each day, I'd douse the coals, rattle the iron gate closed, balance the books by dusk light. Grandma would peep over my shoulder while Granddad scraped burnt bone out of the smoker. She'd laugh bitterly, pop one of those pathetic bills and tell me, Avery, boy, it's raggedy, but it's still money, ain't it? And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. That was beautiful. So our next reading is going to be from Jeffrey.
Thank you, Gordon. And again, I'd like to echo my thanks to the Hurston Wright and to Glory for hosting us, and also my thanks to all the other honorees. This is from my novel, Africaville, and I'll just say that it takes place in Canada, and the first chapter is called Dog Trot Fever. Nova Scotia, 1918. Newborns are never afflicted with the malady. The swollen tongue, the reddish throat, the raw cough seem to afflict only babies older than 6 months. By the spring, in the village situated on a small knuckle-shaped peninsula just north of Halifax, all five of the stricken babies have now developed a high fever. Having no luck with sweet milk and lemon bitter, worried mothers administer castor oil mixed with camphor, then a tea of beer's root seeped with beech, ash, and clover. When desperate, they even place a few charms under the mattresses of the beds where the stricken babies lie crying. Nothing works. In mid-April, with three more babies now suffering from the malady, health department nurses visit the village, their faces frozen even before they have examined a single new case. Why our children, several mothers standing in the yard of one house want to know. Hadn't Halifax already given enough babies in the fire that leveled 10 square blocks of the city months before when the munitions ship exploded in the harbor? Then again, those had been white babies. No colored babies had died in that explosion. Was it now Woods Bluff's turn to lose infants? And if so, how many? 5, 10, all 22? The following week, after two of the feverish babies died, the mothers turned to the grandmothers, though many are leery of this option. Already, several grandmothers have suggested that since the home remedies haven't worked, and since neither nurse nor doctor has useful medicines, the afflicted infants must be bad luck babies. It is an expression the mothers haven't heard since they were children, though the fear of having a bad luck baby had terrorized mothers on the bluff as far back as 1790. That was the first year the groups of cabins sprang up across the bluff, displacing the fox, hare, the moose that ran through the thick Christmas ferns and sheep laurel. Back then, no medicine could invigorate a baby whose body had begun to show the outlines of bones. Smothering was sometimes recommended. Take no action, and bad luck might infect the entire village. Yet several mothers are unconvinced the deceased infants are bad luck babies. And even if the now suffering babies are saddled with bad luck, who's to say those old tales of smothering are true? Had anyone actually seen a mother place a blanket or pillow over a child's face? And most important for these new cases, by what evidence will we make the diagnosis? The grandmothers had ready answers. For several descendants of the Virginian who came up to Nova Scotia in 1772 as a messenger in the British Army, a feverish baby had to be put to sleep if its father had recently had a limb severed above the knee or elbow. Death was also imminent if the baby's fever came during the same month as the mother's birthday. And for the granddaughter of the Congolese woman who in 1785 dressed as a man, sailed into Halifax Harbor on a ship out of Lisbon, a feverish baby had to be smothered if the newborn was smaller than a man's hand. And for the largest group of grandmothers, those descended from the nearly 200 Jamaicans who landed in Halifax Harbor in 1788 after being expelled by British soldiers from their island villages for fomenting rebellion, a feverish baby's fate was sealed if the child coughed up blood during the same month a traveling man arrived on your stoop selling quill turpentine, goat leather, or gunpowder. Hadn't such a vendor made the rounds in Woods Bluff the month before? Why continue to nurse such a child? Death already had a square toe on the baby's throat. It was only a matter of days. A week, maybe, if the baby were a girl.
Oh, Glory, we can't hear you. Wait. Oh, now, sorry about that. I was just saying that was beautiful, Jeffrey. It definitely, we started with the end of a chapter with Ron, and then we started with the beginning of the chapter with you. So we're getting a good mix of all these beautiful narratives. The next person that we have on our list is We just to make one note, we are, Kalisha is here, but she's having some small technical difficulties with her audio. So we want to celebrate her, but she won't be able to read this evening. So our next reader is going to be Sion Dayson.
Hi, thank you so much. It's so great to be here. Just a little confession up front. It's after midnight here in Spain, so I'm a little bit sleepy, but I did not want to miss this event for the world. I'm very honored to be here with the other nominees, and thank you to Hurston Wright and to Glory. So I'm just going to read from the very beginning of my novel, As a River, just to set up the context of the story. So all you need to know going in is that it's 1977, and we're in a small town in Georgia. It should have been harder for a young Black boy to slip undetected from a small southern town, to hitch rides, travel back roads, set sail for who knows where. And yet he did. A boy green to the world has power. A boy freshly cut can move unseen. Greer might have thought demons had come to claim him at the time, but in fact, he had angels too. Now, 16 years later, at age 32, Greer took his first steps back into Bannon. On the exterior, very little had changed since he had last seen it. He, on the other hand, had doubled in age, expanded exponentially in experience. Greer wouldn't say he had left Bannon without a trace. He had sent intermittent postcards, though nothing more than signs he was alive. He knew that some of them arrived because he received a few notes in return, "Forgive me," or "Come home," scrawled on scraps of unlined paper. He didn't expect more words than that. Why would he? He read these things as he sat amidst foreign people under different skies. It wasn't Elizabeth who told him she was sick. Greer had always thought of her as sick, but this was something different. Reverend Smith wrote to him about his mother in an unsure hand. Greer pictured it, the illness, and it wasn't too far from the image he'd always carried of her, that of a tumor resting too close to her heart. Greer bought the bike on a whim. It was a rusty old thing resting against Bannon's worn bus station when he pulled in, a for sale sign hanging on the handlebars. He sussed out who it belonged to within the day, and the bike was his before nightfall. His purchase had to do with finding a new way to travel these streets from a former life, to move faster, to pick up speed. He would not be pulled back in. "Well, I'll be," people would say, people like Wilson, who Greer hadn't even been sure would still be around, an idle thought among the more serious. But there he was, alive and kicking. The first day back, Wilson looked him up and down. "Greer, we about thought you was a ghost." "And how do you know I'm not?" Greer said, only half joking. Greer's mother, used to ghosts, gave him what seemed at first a genuine smile, a rare thing, until it turned into something of a grimace, tears rolling down her face. I'm sorry," she said like an incantation. "Mama, it's okay," he said, putting his arms around this woman, so fragile he could think of nothing but bones. "I'm so glad you're back, baby. Everyone always leaves me. I'm so glad you're back." So Greer is the protagonist of the book, and he fled Bannon when he was only 16 after discovering a haunting family secret. But he's come back now to care for his dying mother. So of course that means confronting the ghosts of his past. And when he returns, he forms an unlikely friendship with a teenager named Celie. So just in the last minute I have, I want to introduce you to her and the river of the book's title. Celie grew up hearing of her own immaculate conception. Kids in the schoolyard would ask who her father was, goading her to say God. She never did, but that didn't stop their taunts. Stories thick as kudzu in that town. Everyone knew about her mother. The town, Bannon, was a small one in middle Georgia, made of dirt roads and modest homes, the air heavy, ground loamy, oak trees and chicken feed, the Cherokee rose that offered a second flowering in the fall if lucky. These were things you saw from the front steps of Wilson's General. People said they could smell Sycamore River, better known as Snake Creek, from half a mile away, about as far as anyone ever went. On warm summer evenings, a remote train whistle would sound, a reminder of other places in the distance. But mainly, like the train's call, a town beyond Bannon was a reality fleeting, then gone. Thank you.
Thank you, that was beautiful. We're going to go on next to Rayon. Hey, how are you? I love the Create and Resist banner in the back. We need some of that right now.
Yeah. I'm going to read a tiny piece of a tiny story called A Loudness of Screechers. And like all my stories, it takes place in my fictional town of Cross River, Maryland. This is narrated by a 16-year-old girl, so please suspend your disbelief, and you can pretend that it's a 16-year-old girl reading. Just before Christmas, the sky turned black with a loudness of screechers flying in impossible patterns. Cracks of light peeked through their ragged feathers. Their wingspans took their breath from us, my little brothers and me, and we pointed and oohed by the window. Every so often, the birds would flap their impressive wings, and we wondered how they stayed up there with so little effort. Both day and night, the bawling from the sky left us awake and red-eyed. Some called the birds cry-cries because of their anguished wails, but screechers always sounded truer to me. Mahad and Jamal ran about flapping and squawking until Umi told them to shut their mouths. "This is not the joke you think it is," she said. My father, my uncle, and about six or seven important men sat in my dad's study, talking real quiet. Josh's dad was there, as was Andrew's mother, the only woman in the bunch. From time to time, they raised their voices in anger, but it would always settle back to a low grumble. "Do 'em like the wolves," a voice, not my father, said. "Bang, bang, do 'em like the wolves." "Sarai," my mother called. "Take your brothers downstairs, please." It wasn't at all fair of Umi to tell me to wrangle two curious five-year-olds. Seems to me now that was her job, but I didn't complain back then. I said, "Okay, you little rats, you heard Umi, downstairs." The little rats ran about, one clockwise, the other counter, squawking, 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 saliva running down their chins. My father stepped from the room, looking taller than usual, his face disturbed and heavy. I froze, grabbed the fleeing Jamal as he dashed by, and pulled him close. I'd seen this face on my father before, and a beating usually followed. He called our names and knelt so he was eye level with my brothers. He pulled us all in, hugging us too tight. The boys squirmed. My back hurt, but I didn't fight. Daddy pressed his face to my stomach. I felt the wetness of his tears soaking my shirt. "I love you all, and your mother loves you all, and your Uncle Charles does too," he said. My uncle walked by, a silver platter in his hands, atop it, the charred wolf that was to be our holiday centerpiece. "Charlie," my father called, but my uncle didn't look back as he moved swiftly out the door. We watched by the window as Uncle Charles bowed before the flying birds in an exaggerated gesture of respect. The important men mumbled among themselves while my parents watched stoically. And when my father could take no more, he turned and shambled away. One of those big black things landed in front of my uncle. With its beak, the bird knocked the wolf from the platter and stared down at Uncle Charles with a condescending glare. "Good Lord," Josh's dad said, "the offering." It screeched in Uncle Charles's face, a sound like 12 air raid sirens. I could feel the sound vibrating at my feet. My uncle was surely now deaf, his eardrums ruptured. Another bird landed and let out more screeching. The two birds rose above his head, beating their wings into one another, pecking at feathers and flesh. My uncle raised his arms in protection. My father burst into the room, shotgun in hand. "No," Andrew's mother called, "this is the ritual." "Fuck the ritual," my father cried. That's my only brother. Some of the important men screamed and snatched at him. He held firm to his weapon, swinging it all about. I'll shoot, he called. I'll shoot. My brothers clung tight to my legs, tears staining their cheeks and shirts. I assured them things would be fine, but my wet face was no better than theirs. Renal, my mother said, finally. Renal, this is the ritual. He held his gun at her, the only thing between him and the door. But the tension had broken. We all knew my father couldn't shoot my mother. This is the ritual, she repeated. Fuck the ritual, my father said, lowering the gun, tears in his eyes. That's my little brother. By then, one screecher lay dead, and the other had snatched Uncle Charles, talons piercing his sides, blood dripping to the streets. He flopped about like a doll in that bird's embrace, climbing higher and higher into the sky. The layer of screechers that blocked the blue cleared, first slowly, then all at once. The loudness flew off, leaving nothing but bird shit and air-splitting wails in its wake. For the first time in weeks, we could see the turquoise and we could see the sun. And now all I felt for them was a fierce hatred. Thank you.
Wow, we might need a ritual for 2020. That was incredible. Thank you so much. Drum. Anyway, our next reading is from Margaret. Hi, Margaret. How are you?
Hi, Glory. That was beautiful, huh?
Wow. That was
incredible. Thank you so much. It's such an honor to be here. Thank you to all the panelists. I'm just thrilled to be here with you. Thank you, Politics and Prose. Thank you, Hurston Wright. And thank you so much, Glory, again, for moderating. So I'm going to read from The Revisioners. And The Revisioners tells a story of a former enslaved woman and sharecropper who, despite her tragic past, is actually content when we find her in 1924. However, this is the year that a white woman moves in next door. And they strike up this cautious friendship, and the friendship is upended when Josephine learns that the woman is a member of the Klan. And then many, many, many generations later, we have Josephine's great, great, great granddaughter, Ava, who is financially strapped. She's a biracial woman who lives in New Orleans. She decides to move in with her wealthy white grandmother just to save money. It's a win-win because her grandmother's health is failing, but her grandmother's behavior soon becomes erratic and even racist. And Ava, the great-great-great-granddaughters, and Josephine's, the great-great-great-grandmother's storylines start to converge. So I'm gonna read a little bit from Ava's section. Ava, 2017. It was King who told me we forgot the photograph. 12 years old, but he'd been washing his own clothes since he was 8 and was often the one to remind me to take the trash out on Thursdays. I didn't intend to place all that responsibility on him. He was a child, but he identified the holes in my capacity and dove into them. While I was filing motions for Mr. Jeff at Wilkerson and Associates, he was microwaving neat squares of beef lasagna. And now this, the picture my grandmother's great-grandmother had had taken of herself, standing at the edge of her farm. Miss Josephine, her husband had just died and you could not miss that in her eyes, the loneliness. But you could also glimpse the pride, the rows of corn, their stalks double her height, the chickens at her feet, a smokehouse with shingles planked toward the roof like two hands in prayer. We could go back and get it, King says. I shake my head. It's too late, I say. And maybe it is, and maybe it isn't. But I'm afraid if I turn back, I won't make it through the stained glass doors of the uptown mansion in front of us. I hadn't fully come to the decision to move here, more like the decision had wound its way through me. And if I had another hour, another drive east, I might just stay over on that side of town where my mama would welcome me. But I was tired of disappointing her. She was hard on me when I was a child. She held so much promise when she'd met my father at Tulane. She was one of the only Blacks on campus and she caught his eye, though the only Black woman he'd known was his housekeeper, Mary. 6 months later, my mother was pregnant. My father went on to law school. She had planned on going too, but it would have been difficult for her without a baby. With me, it was nearly impossible. Still, she did it, all the while working odd jobs as a waitress, caretaker, stenographer. My father felt neglected and took up with a woman from his civil procedure study group. My mother said she was better off without him, but for a long time, when she looked at me, when she answered my questions, when she tucked me into sleep at night, I could sense her bitterness straining through her tight smiles. "We better go in," I say. "It's getting dark." And King lets out a tired sigh. "Why can't we just go to Mama's?" he asks. He's been asking this all week, and I repeat again what I've been saying. "This is a good opportunity for us, King. A better school. We'll see each other more because you'll just be downstairs." "Yeah, but living in this old lady's house, this old white lady," he pauses, "is weird." "No weirder than living with Mama that one time. Probably better, because she won't be all up in our business. Plus, this house is huge. Grandma Martha will have her wing, we'll have ours. You probably won't even see her." He sucks his teeth, but he shifts in his seat and grips the handle of his backpack. When I open my car door, he opens his too. "We didn't pack a whole lot. Our furniture is in storage, and otherwise we don't own much more than our clothes, one lamp, some framed pictures of me and my mother when I was a child, me clinging to her waist like any minute someone might snatch her. We gather the little we can hold and walk up the long brick walkway, past the two-tiered angel fountain in the courtyard, through the iron lace gate. I use my key to open up, and Grandma Martha isn't at the door to greet us, but she's already told me where we'll stay, and I know my way to the second floor. Her room is just beyond us on the third. King has never been inside, and his mouth is open as he sizes it up. The grand crystal chandelier, the red upholstered chairs, the oriental rugs over the mahogany floors, the paintings of her ancestors, their thin lips pressed together. In his room, he sets his backpack down. Just to the side of his four-poster bed, looks out to the driveway where our beat-up white Camry seems out of place. The bed is the height of his waist. I remember at our apartment, he'd flop on his old one after school, and here he has to climb on top. "I told you the house was big," I said. "Too big," he says back. "Too nice. I don't even feel comfortable touching anything." I almost tell him he's right, that he shouldn't touch a thing, but I want him to feel at home here. "You're careful enough," I say. I hear a voice behind me. "You don't need to worry about this old stuff. Grandma Martha." Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret. That was wonderful. There's something so special about listening to the author read their work and really embody the characters and the scenes. Each one of you did a fantastic job, and congratulations again on your nomination. We're so excited for tomorrow, the ceremony. Everyone that's watching at home, we hope you will join us tomorrow and find out who the winner will be. We are going to pose a question to all the panelists. And if you're watching and you have a question, you can place it inside the Q&A. But my question for each one of you is around literary success. If you could share what that means to you individually and how Hurston Wright contributed to that vision of what success means for you. We can start with Jeffrey, if you don't mind.
Well, thank you, Gloria, and congratulations again to all the panelists and wonderful reading. I always like to say that for me, literary success has been really about opportunity and community. It's sort of the opportunity to sort of to find really about who I am and what I think of the world, and an ability to communicate that to others, be it, you know, maybe one reader or a thousand. And so that really, what Hurston Wright has really been to me. I started out with a Hurston Wright doing a community class 20 years ago, taking a class. And so back then, you know, I had no idea that I was gonna, you know, finish a novel. I was basically working on short stories. That's what I thought I would do and continue to work on the short stories. But, you know, they showed some belief in me. And then I went on to write more. And of course, the other thing that when I think of writing is the opportunity to get to meet and be in community with other Black writers. And certainly, this is certainly an opportunity. Since then, I really have been writing on my own for the most part. I've done some residencies here and there, but I really haven't been in a community of writers probably now for about 10 or 15 years. So I'm thrilled to be involved with Hurston Wright again, and also to get to know some of the wonderful writers that I have heard read here tonight.
That is so amazing to hear that 20 years, you are a living testimony of, you know, in the beginning, you had your stories that you're working on, and now fast forward 2020, you're a nominee. That is so fantastic. Congratulations.
Thank you.
We are going to pose the question next to Sion.
Yeah, I think for me, literary success is really just connecting with readers. Like, if the story means something to somebody out there, that's all that matters to me. It took a very long time for this book to find its way into the world. I sent it out to agents, lots of presses, and I kept getting this feedback that it was beautiful, but too quiet. So I had to really stay strong in the belief that there's value in beautiful, quiet things, you know, especially in a world that can be very ugly and noisy as well. And once I started, once it finally got published and people started reading it, it's like, oh, this isn't quiet. It's connecting with people. It's not quiet to talk about everyday people's lives and the stories we tell to survive. And so having this recognition from Hurston Wright really just underscores that, you know, that it's finding a community of people who really understands these stories. So yeah, I feel like it's successful.
It is successful. And that is such a amazing reflection that you have from the, you know, those rejections and those ideas that they didn't see your vision, but you were steadfast in that and you knew what you wanted to share with the world. I think that's great advice for any aspiring writer. And I'm going to say to you as well, congratulations on your nomination. And I after that reading, I need to read your book. So I'm going to be ordering your book as well.
Thank you.
Our next author is, I'm just going to be going in this little order of the boxes. I'm going to go with Rian, if you want to share your idea of success with the audience.
I set out this goal to write this this story, this history, this ongoing story of my fictional town Cross River. You know, it has this fictional history. It was founded after a slave revolt. My idea of success is finishing that and getting that done. You know, when I read August Wilson, I read him over and over again. I just feel so proud and happy for him that he was able to finish those 10 plays in his lifetime. It feels like a victory. So I look at that and say, yeah, that'll be success. And you know, every, you know, moment to moment, you know, whether I am able to be writing on my on a schedule that I like, which is not happening right now, is how I'm measuring it from moment to moment. But you know, I just like Jeffrey said, I also, you know, love connecting with other Black writers, and you know, reading other people's work, championing other Black writers. It's success to have people that I read and look up to say, hey, you know what, I was teaching your work. That feels good to me, and that feels like success.
That's incredible. And I love the example you shared with August Wilson, this idea of creating a whole body of work that goes beyond just one collection. It's part of this fictional town. It also makes me think of, I'm a Nigerian American, and the area that my parents are from is called Cross River. So I think of Nigeria and the diaspora as well. It's such a beautiful connection, how there can be these fictional towns, but there's like in the world that also exists too. It's all the connections. We're all interconnected.
We gotta talk, Glory. Cause I stole the name. I had a great uncle who said he traced our family to that area. So we gotta talk. Totally, we never talked about this before. We gotta what? Talk.
Yeah, we're probably related. Seriously, because Cross River is really, it's a small, it's a very small village in Nigeria. And, you know, most people, when I meet folks here and I'm like, oh, do you know so-and-so? Usually it's like my cousin or something, because there's not a lot of folks in the States that are from Cross River. That's awesome. Okay, wonderful. We're going to go next to Margaret down below.
Hi, I'm loving everybody's answers. It's hard to think of something different. The only thing I can say is that when I first started writing, I had just left a job and I felt like I had something to prove by being published. And I spent so much energy on this book I was writing that ended up never being published, actually. And it was really frantic energy. And it was just, it wasn't coming from a place of wanting to create and wanting to connect to readers. I think it was more about having a little bit of a chip on my shoulder and wanting success in an external way. And this went on for years, and it was very difficult to be published for those years. And then my dad got sick. That's what happened. So my dad got sick, and I think my focus just shifted. And in that shift, I think I got way more perspective on what an honor it was and what a privilege it was to be able to sit down at the computer every day and just be in that world of creation. Like, I just realized how lucky I was that I could even do it, even if nothing ever came from it. The fact that I could just sit there and be in a different world with different people who, you know, were born from my creation, it was such a healing experience for me. Every time I did it, it felt like I was meditating. And I just felt like, you know what, even if nobody ever sees this, how lucky am I that I get to do this a few hours a day? And that's when everything shifted for me in terms of getting published. I think I needed to be looking at it from a different angle. And I'm very, you know, it's hard. It's hard to continue to look at it from that angle as you get published and as you, and as you enter the world of being an author as opposed to a writer. But I try to remember that the main reason I'm doing this is because of the joy I get from creating and because of the fact that I get to say whatever I want to say. I love that. I love that I get very little limitations on what I can express. And I love that, as people have said, that readers connect with it. And it doesn't, when I'm in a good place, it doesn't matter to me how many readers connect to it. I feel like my book will find the readers that it's supposed to find. And that to me is success, that my ideas and my messaging and this world I created gets to travel elsewhere. I feel really proud of that.
Margaret, I think readers who encounter your work can feel that foundation and that sense of being rooted in your work. You have a very clear vision in you. You're just yourself. You know, we've worked together in readings, and I think that's, again, each person, the advice you're sharing and the experience is so encouraging, because writers are trying to figure out who they want to be, what do they want to sound like? And the reality is you have to just be yourself. So thank you for that. So our next author is going to share his idea of literary success is going to be Ron. And then we are going to take some questions from the Q&A section. There's some amazing people that are just giving us some love. So we're going to acknowledge the questions too. So take it away, Ron.
All right. So the idea of literary success is kind of a conundrum, because it feels like everything is so personal and insular. The most success that I feel, or the most important success I feel usually, is if at 3 a.m. when I'm up in the middle of the night wrestling with the story, if I'm like, oh, maybe I should actually go to bed. But then if by 3:30 I found a solution, or at least started on the path to some kind of solution, that's still like one of the most exciting parts of writing to me. And it took some time for me to realize that was the thing that would keep me moving forward. It's taking a lot of pleasure in what's going on the page from line to line, being able to get up the next day and look at what I made with new, fresh eyes. And sometimes even if I was frustrated, accepting that sometimes you might really chew on a story for a week, and then, you know, maybe 2 weeks later, you'll figure it out and it will come together in a way you never imagined. So that's all to say that the conundrum is that you're spending so much time developing something that no one will see in the hopes that somebody will see it, that you're sort of building this wish for community. And in some kind of way, you got to figure out that just what you're able to create is important to you. So by the time that folks are actually reading it, they're actually talking about it, for me, it's really surreal. You know, it's kind of like, wait a minute, you guys are interested in this. This is just what I've been doing at night. So with the nominations and everything that's coming together, it's just really exciting to see that wish for community fulfilled. And I think that's the most important thing. I look forward to moving, progressing and building up more connections and relationships. And that's really just the fun part. If somebody that I've never met before sends me a small note and says like, hey, I read this story and I thought this, or that, you know, I checked out the book, I'm always floored. I'm always just like, you know, is this a fever dream? Do I need to sleep more often? What is actually happening? So it's just an exciting time, and I'm trying to take it all in as it comes.
Thank you. And I just want to give one more shout out to Kalisha. I know we see you there. I'm so sorry that your audio isn't working right now, but please purchase everyone's book. Kalisha's book is Speaking of Summer. All the books are in the chat on the side. You can purchase them from Politics and Prose directly, and those donations will go to the Hurston Wright Legacy Foundation. And as I said before, I want to take some questions from the audience. So give me one second. Let me just pull this up. So the first question here, it says, thank you all for marvelous, incredible readings. Place seems to be a very important feature in each one of your stories. Do Black writers create a place for us to rest ourselves, remember, dream worlds, know ourselves, and create along with you? So I think what David is asking is just the purpose of the stories that you tell, maybe what the collective meaning is, and why you write those questions. And anyone can kick things off if you want to raise your hand to answer David's question. All right, go for it.
You know, when I created this world of Cross River, it was based a lot in sadness that, you know, being a descendant, presumably a descendant of slaves, or enslaved people rather, I'm cut off from a lot of the history. So I was able, you know, for me, I was able to create a homeland, right? This is my space, you know, this fictional world where anything can happen, where people were able to free themselves. That's what I felt when I was creating it. But, you know, I'm teaching a class on this next semester, and I was thinking that, in Black fiction, it often seems like, you know, the imagined or the invented world that is mostly or all Black just seems like a place where characters are resting from white supremacy, or hiding or protecting themselves from white supremacy. And I think it works that way in my fiction as well.
That's interesting. I think the same thing. Like when I'm thinking about the revisioners, I think I was trying to create an experience that I wish I had proof of in my own life. Like I believe that I'm connected to my ancestors. I believe that I can be in, you know, that I can commune with them, but I don't have proof of it. And in this book, it's like, oh, in this world that I've created, it actually is happening. Like we know that for a fact. And the descendant is getting power, and it is something she can rely on and she can draw strength from. And it's a seal against the world of white supremacy. Like the closer she gets to that maternal ancestry, the more power she finds inside herself, and she's able to ultimately leave this grandmother's home, this white grandmother's home. But yeah, I think one of the great things about writing it was that in that moment when I was creating it, I was able to actually feel what it would be like to have that protection all the time.
I would say that a lot of what I'm hearing, I can agree with also. In writing Africaville, one of the things that I found interesting about place was that for a writer, it really is, you know, allows you to be sort of, to wonder about your own place you know, and also about places you don't. And as I began to learn more about this town in Canada, that was very interesting. But then when I started writing some of the scenes set in Alabama, I realized just how little I knew about my own town. And so I think place is a good way for a writer to experience all kinds of creative energies, to spill a lot of creative energies. in their work. So it's an excellent way, I think, into a lot of stories, for me at least.
So I'm going to go on to two more questions. We're running out of time a little bit, but I feel like these two questions connect really well with what you guys just discussed around place. So one of the questions is, how do you begin to create these worlds and stories while remaining original? And then there is a direct question to Sion, because she's living in Europe. How does living in Europe affect your ability to conjure stories set in the U.S.? So it's a kind of a continuation of the first question. Sion or Ron, would you like to take that?
I'll jump in here. I just kind of wanted to add into the conversation of place. One thing that I think that's interesting and is particular to being a Black writer is that the way you're writing place, it pertains to the conditions of your existence. And I often think of survival. I think of when I think of my grandparents and them managing to build a business and maintain their business, the conditions for their success were different than what I have to deal with. But a lot of the same strategies and everything that they had taught me, it still applies. It's just different from generation to generation. So I think that's part of the freshness, is that, you know, whenever you enter a different place, just physically in the real world, you know, you have to consider where you are and what the rules are of engagement, and kind of mining that and trying to go back to, you know, what you were taught and how you can, you know, just get by day to day and also build something of your own and hopefully spread some kind of joy and hope and foundation for not only your future, but for the future of other folks. It's impossible for it not to be fresh if you're looking at it from that standpoint and using a bit of integrity. But I mean, it's interesting.
I'll just answer the specific question since I'm the only one in Europe. James Baldwin is my literary hero, as I'm sure he is for a lot of people. But he lived in France for many years. That's where he wrote most of his seminal work. I lived in Paris for 10 years, so I was sort of following him. and that's where I wrote the book. And, you know, in his famous essay, The Discovery of What It Means to Be an American, he said, "I was alchemized into an American the moment I touched French soil." And I sort of felt that too. That wasn't an identity. I felt like, oh, I'm American, until you find yourself in another culture and you're like, oh, I actually am. You know, I'm an African-American, I'm an American, but that does mean something when you're living in another country. So I feel like the distance actually gives me space to view my home in a different way. And so I actually find it a boon to my work to be so far away. But I also, Bannon is a fictional town as well. So, you know, I also have some freedom, you know, I'm not bound to specifics of a real place either.
So there are a couple more questions. Well, this is a fun social media one. Of course, you know, Well-Read Black Girl is on Bookstagram and on Instagram. And everyone who's watching, if they're on Instagram, they want to know how they can connect with you, how they can follow you and support you on your channel. So if you have an Instagram or Facebook or Twitter you'd like to shout out, please share it with us so we can follow you.
I'm Sion Dayson everywhere. I can say I'm the only Sion Dayson in the world, so I'm very easy to find.
Mine is Ree, R-E-E, Amilcar Scott on Twitter and Instagram.
I simply have a website, jeffreycolvin.com. That's about it for me.
I'm at mwilkers13 on Instagram and Twitter, and Margaret Wilkerson Sexton on Facebook.
What about you, Ron?
Oh, I'm at ronaaustin.com. I have a Instagram and a Twitter, but I don't keep up with them too much, but I'll check in there. But yeah, the website, ronayelston.com, that's a good place to start.
Okay, let me see if I can find Kalisha's. Okay, so Kalisha is at Kalisha Online on Instagram. So I think we have like two more minutes, and there's this question here at the very bottom. And when you were speaking, Margaret, you talked about the difference between being a writer and an author. And I think it'd be helpful for the viewers to kind of know, what did you mean by what's the difference between a writer and an author?
Yeah, I just meant my mentor and my editor used to talk about it all the time when I was writing A Kind of Freedom, my first book. She would be like, just enjoy it, because once you become an author, you'll be really competitive and, you know, sensitive. And I'd be like, no, I would think, no, I would just be excited to be published. I won't care. But of course, that's she was right. So but the difference in my mind is just that a writer is not yet published. Is that a real distinction, or is that just me and my editor? An author is published and a writer is not yet published. Is that right?
What do you guys think? I'm gonna leave it to the in the nominees.
That's how you feel. Okay.
Yeah,
I agree with that.
All right. So it said, so once you're published, you're an author. That is the clear distinction. So everyone watching, let's put it out there. I want to say thank you to all the nominees. I want to say thank you to the Hurston Wright Foundation. They're part of my literary family, and I'm so honored to support them whenever I have the chance. And thank you to the Indie Bookstore, Politics and Prose. They are absolutely incredible. I'm going to do one more plug to buy the books right now. Buy them for friends, buy them for Christmas, for birthdays. This is such a crucial time for authors right now because of the pandemic and the inability to meet in person, to do book tours and such. So if you can support all of the authors nominated in every category, we encourage you to do so. This was a lot of fun. Thank you so much for just sharing your work. And we will see everyone hopefully tomorrow at the virtual gala. Put on your best outfits.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. See you later.
Bashani, you want to take it away?
You did an excellent job. I just wanted to also thank everyone from Politics and Prose for this wonderful event. And of course, thank everyone who's viewed and participated in this event with your wonderful questions. Once again, the actual award ceremony is tomorrow for anyone who wants to tune into that. And as always, keep reading books, keep buying more books, and everyone stay safe.